Hello and welcome to Soberanía, the Mexican Politics Podcast. I'm your co-host, José Luis Granados Ceja, Mexican-born journalist living and working here in Mexico City, writing for Venezuela Analysis and editing the Mexico Solidarity Media website. And as always, I'm joined by my co-host, Kurt Hackbarth. How you doing, Kurt?
Very well, José Luis. My name is Kurt Hackbarth from Jacobin Magazine in Sentido Común here in Mexico, ready for another episode of Soberanía.
Excellent. We got a lot to talk about. It's a good thing we switched to this weekly format. Today, yeah. We're going to do real quick comments here on the debate. We want to encourage everybody to check out the live stream we did with Violeta Vázquez Rojas, who joined us last night to break down the debate immediately afterwards. It was, you know, a lot of what most of us expected it to be. I don't think any minds were changed, but still important to give that analysis in terms of, you know, what are the takeaways from it? What are the lessons from that experience of watching the debate? And we, again, want to encourage everybody to check out the live stream. It's up on our YouTube page. And if you hear a full analysis, it's about 35 minutes long, just breaking down what we saw, what we thought, the highlights, the lowlights, the usuals that comes out of these kinds of exercises. Kurt, I don't know if there's anything you want to add when it comes to that.
Well, yeah, go and watch the live stream. Basically, I think we've talked about in the program about how, you know, this the danger of importing ideas, right? So yeah. Jorge Castaneda, the analyst, spoke a few weeks ago about the need for Xóchitl Gálvez to go negative, right? Very much along the lines of U.S.-style negative campaigning. And it blew up in her face. It really blew up in her face, really, this idea of going negative last night. I'd mentioned in Twitter that not only is going negative problematic in general, it's particularly problematic if the candidate goes in with high negatives, because right. It's only going to reinforce the negatives. And that's exactly, I mean, you know, hardly am, you know, am I to claim to have a crystal ball, but that is exactly what happened.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, in the larger sense, too, the National Electoral Institute failed its test. They also imported an American-style, you know, debate format, which, you know, doesn't really work because you try to cram too much into very small bites of, you know, of time, and they managed to make it even worse, you know, yeah. With the problems with the clock and the timing, the sound, you know. This is the National Electoral Institute, which is one of the most expensive electoral institutes in the world, and they should have had their act together. And they didn't.
And in fact, that's one of the things they always boast about, right? No. Mm-hmm. Just sure, it's expensive, but we're one of the best, and we received so much recognition. But honestly, they dropped the ball last night, and to the detriment of the country, right? It affects the political discourse. It makes things a little bit poorer, because like I said last night, I think people are going to tune out. You know, the ratings will probably be down for the next two. People are going to feel detached, and I would rather have a much richer debate about the two visions for the country. I know there's a third candidate, but really, if anything, he maybe benefited some. I've seen some quick polling after the debate, and it looks like maybe he got a little bit of a bump, but not to the detriment of Claudia, but to Xóchitl. So she needed to have a good debate, and she didn't. But like I said, check out our full live stream where we get into that. There's a lot to talk about Mexican politics here on Soberanía. And we're actually going to begin with a discussion about what's probably on everybody's mind, which is what happened between Ecuador and Mexico with the invasion of the Mexican embassy in Quito, Ecuador. And to begin our discussion on that, I'd actually like to share this video with you, which is subtitled, brought to you by our friends over at Gausachung News. I'm going to play it in its entirety. It'll be in Spanish, and then we'll comment on afterwards for our viewers who are, or listeners who are only listening and not viewing the screen. We'll explain a little bit what he says afterwards.
Me he golpeado contra el suelo y físicamente traté de impedir que entraran como delincuentes allanaron la Embajada de México en Ecuador. Esto no es posible. No puede ser. Es una locura.
¿Se lo llevaron a su casa?
Sí. Estoy muy preocupado porque pueden matarlo. No hay ningún fundamento para hacer esto.
So, That's the video there. I'll stop it there just so we can kind of fill folks in who are just listening. That is the charge of affairs at the time. He's now back in Mexico, Roberto Canseco. He was inside the Mexican embassy in Quito at the time when it was raided by police. Violation of the convention, the Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations Between Countries, extraordinary. I think you can see and you can hear in his tone sort of the shock of it, right? Like, he literally says, this can't be. Es una locura. This is unbelievable that they would do this. And that was my reaction. I was actually in bed Friday night when I saw the messages coming through, like, have you seen what's happening right now? But quite literally, my jaw was on the floor as a shock at that they would be willing to do this. I know this has been said a lot when around the discussion about this incident, but not even the worst dictatorships in the Southern Cone in the history of Latin America went to these lengths to totally violate a space that is not supposed to be violated in this sense, that is sacred. This is the basis of international relations. Now that, you know, we can get into a whole discussion about, you know, what are the problems with international law? But nonetheless, the reason there's so much emphasis on having this kind of respect for these spaces, for these diplomatic spaces, is that when you don't respect that, then you close the door to peaceful resolution of conflicts. That's why it's such a sacrosanct thing, and why it's so extraordinary that the president of Ecuador, Noboa, son of one of the richest men in Ecuador, decided to make this to take this course of action, all in effort to further engage with the political persecution of the citizens' revolution, the Correistas, in Ecuador. Just absolutely extraordinary. Like I said, and so for those of you who are just listening, he's just talking about how he physically tried to stop them from actually entering the space, from taking away Jorge Glass. You know, he mentioned that he's worried he might be killed. Just this morning, there were some reports saying that, you know, he was taken to hospital over some issues around the medication that he was receiving. He's of delicate health to begin with. There was already a risk when he was previously jailed that he might suffer ill health as a result. So I don't think we should discard the possibility that something quite terrible could happen to Jorge Glass now that he's been. And we should be correct about this. He has not been detained. He has been kidnapped. Detain somebody when it happens under a place that is your jurisdiction. The Ecuadorian National Police has no jurisdiction over what happens inside the Mexican embassy. This was a kidnapping.
Yeah, there's a lot to unpack here, José Luis. And that video, I think it's hard to overestimate the impact that video has had in Mexico. Roberto Canseco is being seen as a national hero for physically putting his body on the line to try to prevent Noboa's thugs from entering the area of the embassy, which, as you very correctly said, that's the photo that's done, you know, the rounds of Mexico many times, which, as you very rightly said, is sovereign territory of the nation in question, right? That's the Vienna Convention, and that's also the Caracas Accords there.
That's right. And for our listeners, there's an image on the screen here of Canseco being detained on the ground, two police officers pinning him down, physically restraining him from actually being able to get up off the ground, because there's a scene of the vehicles leaving the embassy and he's chasing after it, kind of an act of desperation to try to stop what's happening.
Yeah. So on one hand, you have, you know, Roberto Canseco, who was, you know, a la altura de las circunstancias, as we say in Spanish, right? He was up to the, you know, to the moment. And then you have some of the worst elements of the Mexican right excusing this, right? I made a collage of tweets of a bunch of people, you know, some of the usual suspects, you know, Dolia Estevez and, you know, right-wing commentators and the like, basically trying to blame AMLO for this crime of violating an embassy, right? And we'll get to that in a moment. It just, you know, just when you think the Mexican opposition can't get any worse and can't sell out any more to foreign interests, they try to excuse through a selective reading of the accords, right? So the Caracas Accord said at one point that somebody who is, you know, under prosecution can't be granted asylum, but it also says right after that that it is the country giving asylum, granting asylum, that decides what the status of that person is, right? In this case, Mexico. Mexico was in the process of granting asylum to the former vice president, Jorge Glass, right? So it's the asylum granting country that decides what that person's status is, right? Not, you know, the other country, because if that wasn't the case, asylum would be a dead letter. Asylum could never exist, because you could always trump up a charge and say this person is, you know, under arrest for whatever else, we're coming in to get him. Asylum wouldn't exist if there weren't the principle that it's the asylum-granting country that decides, right? And the fact that, you know, the Mexican right was basically copying Noboa's, you know, excuse for it is pathetic. It's pathetic, right? That, you know, on one hand, right? So let's just backtrack a little bit, because I think it's very important to kind of know how we got here, right?
Yeah.
Over the course of the last week, López Obrador commented twice in the Mañanera in his morning press conference about the suspicious circumstances of the Ecuadorian presidential election of last year, and they were very suspicious. There were three presidential candidates, right? There was Noboa, there was the candidate of, you know, the Correa tendency of Rafael Correa,
yeah, and a third candidate,
right, who was assassinated, right, under very, you know, strange circumstances. And AMLO simply pointed out, it's very strange, you know, that that person, this candidate is assassinated. The Correa candidate, who then was accused of being, you know, involved in narco, you know, it's funny how they trundle out the narco argument again, just as we saw that they tried to do against López Obrador in ProPublica, in the New York Times, as we've covered extensively in this program. Well, they do the same thing there.
Yeah.
They do the same thing there against the Correa candidate, right? And then with these accusations of narco and violence. So the Correa candidate declines precipitously in the polls, and Noboa wins. Right? A surprise candidate kind of came out of nowhere.
I wanted to jump in on that real quick. I have a tweet that I wrote on the screen here. And I talked specifically about that. I mean, watch out, because very soon after all of this started to go down, we saw lots of efforts to try to say, well, it's López Obrador's fault for commenting on what's happening on Ecuador, as if he was totally out of left field, totally out of place to be saying this. And the truth is, now, I lived in Ecuador. I was a journalist there for over 2 years. I became intimately familiar with the politics there. And, you know, I felt a certain responsibility to you know, better understand the country I was living in at the time. I was working for Telesur. But I've obviously kept that interest alive. And so I've been following Ecuadorian politics since I left the country back many years ago now. And we have to be clear about this. What's happening in Ecuador is an effort to marginalize the most powerful political force in that country. Rafael Correa, elected as part of that first pink wave, made massive changes. In a lot of ways, we could think of him as the López Obrador of Ecuador, of kind of ushering out that old regime, bringing in something new, investing in people, redistributing wealth, et cetera, et cetera. The best years of Ecuador were the Correa years. Now, Correa decides not to run again for presidency. He taps his first vice president, Lenin Moreno, to be the candidate. And, you know, it was a bit of a risky move in the sense that he was, you know, not cut from the same cloth. He was, you know, not really much of a politician. He was tapped back then to kind of soften Correa's image. And, you know, there was some fear, will he be able to win? And if he wins, will he keep the citizens' revolution going? So he wins, but before he even takes office, it's evident that Lenin Moreno is a traitor. He's a traitor to his party, he's a traitor to his movement, he's a traitor to the people of Ecuador, and he starts ruling with that old regime that had been kicked out. It's as if, you know, here in this election, Claudia wins and suddenly turns against everybody who helped get her elected, right? It would be an extraordinary slap to the face. And one of the first things he does is actually take away the authority he had delegated to Jorge Glass, Correa's second vice president, and Lenin Moreno's vice president,
right,
and then goes after him with lawfare with trumped up charges. I read this piece in World Politics Review this morning saying, Jorge Gas is clearly corrupt. The justice system in Ecuador cannot be trusted. It is thoroughly rotten. And I think in a lot of ways with what's happening here in Mexico, it's one of the ways that the conservatives are continuing to exercise power, even though they don't have as much influence over the state as they used to. And this whole campaign against Jorge Glass is driven by political interest. And this whole thing about what López Obrador was talking about him pointing to this very suspicious circumstances, I think is outlined here quite well in a tweet from around the election time, October 9th, 2023, from Guillaume Long, former foreign minister for Rafael Correa. And he talks about this, and I'll read out just the first couple of tweets where he says this, you know, in Ecuador, when you think you've seen it all, well, no. In a brazen attempt to affect the outcome of Sunday's election, the prosecutor general has leaked and may even announce that a witness has accused Correistas for the murder of presidential candidate Villavicencio. Conveniently, on Friday, the seven hitmen arrested for the assassination were all murdered simultaneously in two separate jails, so in the Lasso government's custody. The hitmen's disappearance ensures they will never reveal who hired them, nor who in the state was part of the plot. Absolutely assuring. This is what López Obrador was talking about. He's not wrong. Obviously, the case is still open. What happened with Villavicencio, we don't know. We can't say for definitively. No one has ruled on it. But the idea that he's wrong for pointing to the very suspicious circumstances, Luisa González is leading in the polls. All of a sudden, Villavicencio is assassinated, and now she drops and ultimately loses in the second round to the son of this banana oligarch, Noboa, in Ecuador. I think it does deserve some scrutiny. Now, Noboa obviously understands that this threatens his legitimacy, and that's why he's reacted so sharply, but I personally did not think he was willing to go this far. I did not think that he was going to do what he just did. And in fact, we actually already seen his response. He just published this on his Twitter account 1 hour ago. So we're recording on Monday afternoon, so this went up at 2:15 p.m. local time, April 8th, where Noboa basically makes a statement to the international community. Now, we should be clear. Nobody is backing Ecuador in the international community. Zero. And I'm not exaggerating. There are some pundits. There are some reactionaries. There are some
the
fascists.
Mexican right. That's it.
The Mexican
not
right.
Not even Milei in Argentina, right?
Not even Milei. I think that's extraordinary. He's alone. And I think he understands that. That's why he issued this letter. But anyway, I've spoken enough already. Kurt, your thoughts on this effort to try to lie to the public about what's actually happening in Ecuador, to try and take advantage of the fact that people are unfamiliar with the political dynamics there and trying to profit from it politically.
Yeah, so thanks for that very important kind of historical context there, because that's exactly what the media doesn't give you and doesn't want you to know, right? The lawfare being used against Jorge Glass has already been 5 years in prison, right? I think this is his third series of charges against him. Right. And, you know, we can't ignore that the storming of the Mexican embassy happened just days after Israel's bombing of the Iranian consulate, you know, in the same grounds of the embassy in Damascus. Right. Where is international law? Well, you know, the rules-based order that lead to a state where there's no rules whatsoever, right? As you very well pointed out at the very beginning of this program, not even Pinochet did this, right, after the coup in Chile in 1973, when hundreds of people from the Allende government hid out in the Mexican embassy. Hundreds. And they got them out. Right? Not even Videla in Argentina after the coup there in 76, and that was a particularly vicious coup and regime.
Yeah.
Right? There is one case, you know, where after the Uruguay coup, they did go into the Venezuelan embassy and grab somebody in the 70s. But it's practically unheard of for exactly the reasons that you've laid out. So you'll see even the worst dictators, you know, recognizing that, you know, embassy status is sacred.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So the response of the world community has been, you know, virtually unanimous. This should be a pretty easy one. This should be a no-brainer, right? This should be, you know, the unanimous response of all 200 countries in the world, because, you know, that's international law right there, right? So what are the two countries, José Luis, that did hedge on this and didn't come out forthrightly on this?
I don't think we should be surprised. The United States and Canada, the two imperialist powers here in the Western Hemisphere.
So let's start with the U.S. These are, of course, Mexico's great allies, you know, Mexico's free trade partners, you know, supposed to be, you know, they're great pals. I'm obviously being sarcastic, right? Faced with a blatant violation of international law that isn't even, I mean, there's no, you know, unless you're some, you know, unless you're the Mexican right trying to make, you know, political points, there's no, you know, this is about as black and white as you get in the international arena. You know, your Ecuadorian police stormed the embassy, physically mistreated Jorge Glass, kidnapped him, physically mistreated Roberto Conseco, the chief of mission. You know, that is what happened, right? So here's what, you know, Matthew Miller, who's become infamous for his comments about Israel.
His, you know, smarmy comments, his smirk as he talks about the deaths of thousands of children. That Matthew Miller?
That Matthew Miller, right? Yeah. So what he says in this case, and it took them the whole day to come out with this. It took them a whole day, the whole day of Saturday to come out with this. Now, if you're, you know, on the other side of the world, okay, maybe it can wait till Monday, right? But not in this case. This is right there. This is right there. This is, you know, right in your area, right?
This is one of those pick up the red phone and issue an emergency statement.
Immediately, that night or first thing in the morning. So it takes them the whole day. And then, you know, Miller comes out with, the United States condemns any violation of the Vienna Convention on diplomatic relations. Not this violation, any violation. Well, right, me too. I condemn any violation, you know, of whatever. That's easy, any violation. That's the way to avoid talking about this case in particular. And then it says, we encourage our partners, Mexico and Ecuador, to resolve their differences in accord with international norms. Now, this is particularly insidious, because what it does is it lumps together the aggressor, which is Ecuador, and the victim of the aggression, which is Mexico. Right? That's like saying to, you know, a victim of domestic abuse, we want the abuser and the abusee to work out their, you know, work out their differences together. It's a tepid little non-statement that is just kind of shows them they're going to be the poster child of cowardice, right? Now, whether it's because they have their fingers all over Ecuador, which we'll talk about in a minute, which is one factor, or because they figured, well, we just basically washed our hands of the Damascus consulate bombing, so now we can't look hypocritical condemning too much the storming of a consulate here, because, oh, Israel just a few days ago just blew up a consulate and killed an Iranian general.
Yep.
Right? So, oh, let's just kind of go easy on this one. Right? So that's the U.S., and then let's go to Canada. Which is no better, and, you know, no one should expect any better. It starts out moderately better because at least it talks about this particular case instead of any violation. It says, we call on all countries to respect both international law and the integrity of domestic legal processes and urge Mexico and Ecuador to engage in dialogue, but then again, here we go, to resolve their differences in the spirit of peaceful coexistence typical of our close regional partners.
Yep.
What it did say in the previous tweet, because there's a tweet before this in the thread, I don't know if you can pull that up. That's the second tweet in the thread. At least in the first tweet in the thread, if you go up just a little bit there, it talks about, there it goes, the apparent breach can't say breach. It's his apparent breach of the Vienna Convention by entering the Embassy of Mexico without authorization. At least it mentions the specific case. And then it just copies. It actually really just plagiarizes U.S. language about urging them to engage in dialogue.
Right? You know, when I saw this message from Canada, it actually reminded me of Canada's insidious role in the 2009 coup in Honduras. They were the first ones to use exactly this kind of language, saying both sides are wrong and both sides need to resolve their differences. Meanwhile, it was the Honduran president who was kidnapped in his pajamas and taken to a third country in the middle of the night. So when it comes to that, who's the aggressor? In this case, in Ecuador, there is no room for debate. Mm-hmm. The Ecuadorian police, without permission, it's now been confirmed by the Mexican officials that there was no dialogue, there was no heads up, that this was done unilaterally by the Ecuadorian National Police on the orders of the Interior Minister with the approval of the president, all of this has come out, to violate the embassy, to go in there and kidnap a man who was under, by that time, the protection of Mexico. And yet they're trying to claim like it's both sides, as if both people somehow committed an offense. You know, oh, Mexico must have also been complicit in this event because they dared to give asylum to somebody they perceive to be. You know, all those people who are citing Article 3 of that convention should read a few inches below Article 4, which says the country declaring whether or not they are going to grant asylum, the ones who decides if it is politically motivated. It's not like repressors go out there and say, I'm politically persecuting you. No, they invent charges. That's what we call it, lawfare. Of course, that's why it's actually in the hands of the country that's recognizing or not if it is political persecution.
So it's just a slimy little hedge, right, on both sides, and it's very paternalistic. It's like, oh, work out your problems, little countries, right? Because we're not going to, you know, we're not going to make any kind of pronouncement that requires any kind of effort, right?
Let's pause a second for there on Canada, right? Why is this so concerning, even from like a liberal framework? Canada has a lot of mining interests in Ecuador. Canadian mining companies are deeply, deeply invested in many spaces throughout Ecuador. In Ecuador, there is a very powerful indigenous movement organized under the CONAIE, but obviously there's a lot of different kind of groups and factions within it. Nonetheless, it's a militant, anti-capitalist, defense of the territory kind of organization. What is to stop them from invading the Canadian embassy and kidnapping the Canadian ambassador in the name of protecting their territories? What? I mean, you can't actually set this precedent, because if you do, you're walking into a mine trap. Why should any country in the world trust that its embassies and its personnel are going to be protected by Ecuador when they've just shown they're not willing to do it? And in the irony of ironies, you talked about the attack in Damascus. Days before this goes down, the Ecuadorian representative to the United Nations goes on this huge speech about respecting the Vienna Convention. And then his country days later goes, I'd be so embarrassed to be, I would resign my post if I was that gentleman and say, I can't stand to be made such a laughingstock by the entire world. We have to underline that. Nobody has sided with Ecuador on this. Nobody. The best you can get are these half-hearted statements from Canada and the United States.
And the other point to add here, which is very important, right, is, you know, Ecuador is in the process now of, you know, another war on drugs, right? Along the lines of the Merida plan in Mexico, along the lines of the plan Colombia, right? And this this graphic here is very interesting, right? Of the 800 or so military bases of the United States around the world, there's quite a few of them in Latin America, right? Including two in Ecuador, right? There are very few countries in Latin America that don't have a U.S. military base in their soil.
I think it's worth mentioning which ones. Mexico, Venezuela, Bolivia, Cuba. These are the countries that defend national sovereignty.
Right. So this is very important. Just in October of last year, the outgoing government of Guillermo Lasso signed a pair of security agreements with the United States, which will allow the presence of American troops on Ecuadorian soil, and also the use of the American Navy in Ecuadorian waters. Right? Noboa has just ratified them. Right? So they've gone through. Right? So here you have it. Right? Everyone's favorite ghoul, Laura Richardson, right, of Southcom, right, happily shaking the hands of United Fruit Boy Noboa here, right, the Banana King, right, and as Aníbal Garzón points out, I think very correctly in this tweet, just as Israel, because they're a United States partner, is allowed to carry out a genocide, Ecuador is now going to have the power to assault an embassy, right? Because that's where we're at now, right? If you're a U.S. partner, green light. But genocide, assaulting an embassy, all these things that are supposedly unthinkable, they're just happening one after the other,
right? And I've been racking my brain about this. I've been trying to figure out what's the end game here, right? Because a country like Ecuador, I love that country. I was there during the earthquake. I met so many people that profoundly impacted me as a person, as a journalist. So I want to be very careful about this. But we have to recognize where Ecuador's place is in the global division of labor. It is not a large country. It primarily exports primary goods, right? It is very much subject to the whims of imperialism, of the global regional dynamics, right? It is very difficult for it to play an independent role in the region, even though it has historically, I think particularly under Correa, played an outsized role in international relations, right? What is the game here? I think it's very much try to sow division throughout South America, try to weaken Ecuador's relationship with China, to try to make it seem like it's on the outs, right, with its neighbors, and break up regional unity, which is critical to being able to face up to the power of U.S. imperialism in the Western Hemisphere, in the Americas. So this is very much about sowing division in the region. I think that's their game. I think that's why this happened, and I think that's probably why when this started to play out, the United States did not tell them to stop, and why they issued such a weak statement. Like you said, they're deeply invested in it, but I think there's a greater chess game being played here. And it's about weakening regional unity. We saw, for example, the efforts at reestablishing diplomatic relations with Venezuela after the election of progressive and leftists throughout the region, in Brazil and other places, in Colombia, et cetera, et cetera. And so now this is that, no. Don't start to get any ideas that you can actually operate as a bloc, because if you do, we're going to do these kinds of things to really break up that relationship. I think ultimately that's what they're trying to do.
Yeah,
and maybe possibly turn it into the Israel of South America now that they lost Colombia.
So you see Javier Milei in Argentina, right, with his tantrums, and Colombia withdrawing its ambassador there. Milei is perfect for the U.S. because he's like a bomb, which can help sever relations among countries. You've got the Noboa case here, right? Mexico, we have to be clear, broke diplomatic relations with Ecuador following this, as of course they had to, right?
Yeah.
So Mexico does not have, and they've evacuated their personnel, right?
Yeah.
So it's exactly what you're saying. There has been a move in Latin America over recent years to get to some degree of regional cooperation. There's been a move, in large part led by Mexico, to go against the OAS and try to replace the OAS with something else. At this moment, CELAC has been the one most used, the Organization of Latin American and Caribbean States. But the United States is very, very pending on this. Don't like it at all, don't want it at all. And so if they've got to resort to this, well, they certainly will.
And I think there's important for us to mention as well, right? I heard some voices saying, like, it's time to go to war, right? They violated our... hang on. Whoa, pump the brakes, right? Mm-hmm. That's not what we want. We don't want an armed conflict between neighbor nations, right? They are part of this community. We are part of Latin America. And if there are voices clamoring for war, I'd be the first one to say, stop. That's not what we want, because the working class will pay the price for that war, right? I mean, let's not get ahead of ourselves here. Now, there were a number of voices, including some progressive voices out there, saying that this is the link. That is not where we should go. And I think we should be very clear about that, that those voices that are calling for that would actually only feed into this division and make things much, much worse. Like, as much as it is an offense what happened, I think Mexico's decision to go to the International Court of Justice, where states dispute their differences, is the right move. And I do think that there should be a repercussion for this. It needs to be clear to the international community that you can't do these kinds of actions. And if you do, there will be consequences. I'm not in favor of economic sanctions against any country. We've seen the effect of those in Cuba and Venezuela. But I do think that the individuals who were involved in this decision making, including a Mexican national who serves as the foreign minister, should face consequences, likely criminal consequences. You can't kidnap a citizen that is under the protection of another state. And then maybe we can close on this point. Noboa is serving a truncated term. He is serving what is left of Lasso's term after he stepped down using one of the articles of the Constitution in Ecuador that permits him to. He decided not to run for re-election. So the election that was recently held was to kind of finish out that one. There's going to be a regular election happening very soon. I think a lot of what Noboa is doing is trying to set himself up so that he can be well positioned. He even mentioned that in this letter that he published just recently, where he talks about that, in fact, makes a very clear connection where he says, we have to understand what we're playing for here in this country. We will see that when the majority of Ecuadorians go to vote, they will vote for national dignity in the popular consultation on 21st of April, the maximum democratic expression of a country. So clearly, he's now linking what happened to the vote that's set to happen in a couple of weeks on the 21st of April to kind of, and if you look at pictures online, you can see they're promoting this referendum by using images of the president. So he's just, this is what we call actas anticipada. So basically, he's campaigning now for election when it comes. And so the political dimension can't be lost as well. But I do think that he and the foreign minister and the actual people who carried out this raid should face consequences for it. And I hope that the court is able to actually do something about it.
Yeah.
So for our next topic, closing on this one, we have some domestic news about what's happening here in Mexico. And it's, of course, related to the election. We had a very interesting event shortly after we recorded our last one, where it turns out that Xóchitl Gálvez's son got into some trouble and was all over the headlines for a moment there. Now, it's a bit of a delicate subject because, you know, Claudia Sheinbaum herself said we shouldn't involve the candidate's children in this. But I will say this, right? He had a political post. He accepted a position on his mother's campaign team and I think should face the consequences of his decisions that he made not too long ago, less than a year ago, that has brought about this scandal and caused issues for his mother's campaign. But I'm being a bit vague here. Kurt, tell us, what am I talking about here? What happened with Xóchitl Gálvez's son and then also a few days later with her daughter?
Oh, okay. This is one of those scandals that you could just kind of get out of a television program about, you know, politics. This is like the classic oh shit scandal, right? This is the oh shit scandal. So I don't know if we can maybe pull up the video. So as you just pointed out, Xóchitl Gálvez decided last year to put her children in key positions in the campaign, right? That was her decision, right? For whatever reasons, and we can discuss it, she decided to make this guy here, Juan Pablo, the head of the youth networks in the campaign, to go out basically to do youth outreach to try to get young people to vote for Xóchitl, because that's actually her worst demographic, right? I mean, she's not doing well in any demographic, but she's doing particularly poor in the 18 to 25 demographic, right? So what came out was her son out in front of a club in the most exclusive part of Mexico City, Polanco, which is, as José Luis pointed out, was based on Beverly Hills, right? in the part of the city, if I'm not mistaken, where his mother was the delegada, basically the head of that bureau, head of that head of that district, right?
Yep.
So, the way, we don't have the audio on in there, but what he's basically saying is he's insulting the bouncers. He's saying, basically calling them poor by saying that they eat tacos, right? He's saying that they don't have any balls, right? He repeats this repeatedly. Where are your balls? Where are your balls? Right? Because they're not beating them up. Because they know they can't, because he's the son of the delegada, right? He's also says at another point, there you go, you sell out for 3 pesos. He also said at one point he could batter a woman if he wanted to. I mean, it's just, it's a really bad video. And it goes on for 5 minutes. He's obviously clearly drunk or high on whatever. And it just crystallizes so much of what we've talked about the Mexican rights, racism, classism problem. It just distills it. It's all there. If anyone, you know, might have thought that we had been maybe exaggerating a little bit over these last episodes talking about the posters and the signs you see at the rallies and the comments that people make. We're not. If anything, we're probably understating the case. When you see something like this, he goes on for 5 minutes. He's misogynistic. He's, you know, he's racist against the bouncers. He's classist. He's basically just saying everything. I can do whatever I want because I'm the delegate's son and I'm lighter skinned. And they just have to kind of contain him for 5 minutes as he goes on and tries to be this tough guy, right? This tough guy, right? So it was a brutal video and a brutal blow to what was an already failing campaign by Xóchitl Gálvez, which then required her campaign to scramble, right? So then you get, again, the excuses, you know, right? From the same people who tried to excuse, you know, days later, the storming of an embassy against international law, you get people trying to excuse this, saying, basically, boys will be boys. Mm-hmm. He was underage. He was 17. Not true.
Not true.
Well, then they said, well, it was a whole year ago. Actually, not true. It was in November of last year, so it was recently, right? We've all gotten drunk and done stuff. Right. Well, if you're a rich white kid in the son of the delegada, maybe, but the average Mexican knows they couldn't get away with this.
Oh God, no.
Wouldn't even want to. But I mean, you know, they'd get beaten senseless and maybe more. Right. So just the distillation of all of this privilege, all this nasty bilge, coming out of his mouth, and. So he had to come out and apologize. He had to resign from the campaign, right? As José Luis pointed out, you know, Claudia Sheinbaum, you know, did the proper thing from the point of view of the presidential candidate, saying we're not going to, you know, we're not going to get involved in going after a candidate's children, as did the first lady, Beatriz Mueller, who's, you know, had to defend her children against all kinds of things. But as Alejandro Páez Varela and Alvaro Delgado and Julio Astillero and a lot of other, you know, journalists of high prestige in the country pointed out, he was a member of the campaign.
Yeah.
He had a position in the campaign. So the nepotism is the problem. If you didn't want him to be facing this kind of scrutiny, you should never put him in the campaign in the first place.
Exactly. Exactly. And I think you hit the nail on the head when you talked about it. Basically what it did was for, in the eyes of many, was confirm what they always suspected about Xochitl and her campaign and the parties that are backing her. You got to remember, we've talked about it on this program. Why was she chosen? She was a bit of a marketing exercise. She could sell a little bit better. She is the daughter of a man who is Otomi, indigenous, and therefore has the popular touch. And this video comes out and basically betrays all of that, right? I mean, what kind of lessons did you teach your son to make him think that he can adopt this kind of attitude with people who are darker skinned, who are earn less money than he does, right? And it just served to confirm that, no, she's not any different. She's more of the same, these kind of attitudes. And this isn't new. in Mexican politics. The children of political leaders in this country have been a huge headache. I remember when Peña Nieto's daughter called us a bunch of proles, proletarians, right? Mm-hmm. This is their attitude. They think they're above society. They think that this country belongs to them. It's a kind of almost a feudalistic attitude. And I think, you know, the fact that she canceled all of her events as a result of this scandal.
She canceled her events the next day. Yeah.
How much they were worried about the impact of this. And I think they were hoping they would bounce back with the debate, but they didn't. And then it was followed up by another scandal involving her daughter. Which it turns
just very
out.
Quickly, just very quickly on too. Are you talking about president's kids? Remember the Ernesto Cedillo's kids at the U2 concert?
Right? Oh, yeah. Yeah. Were their guards just the. Well, actually, they weren't guards. They were members of the Mexican military. Yep.
Who beat up. Who did they beat up there? Somebody from the U2's.
It was actually from the
team.
The band's. Yeah.
Yeah.
Entourage. Yeah.
Because the kids were acting up. And this became. An instance of the fact that you two refused to play concerts in Mexico for, I think, over a decade after that because of those kids. Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is the extent of the sense of overweening sense of entitlement here. So let's go on to this next example.
Yeah. So, sin embargo, did a little bit of digging. You mentioned Álvaro Delgado. He's the head of investigations there. And it turns out that Xóchitl Gálvez's daughter, who again, it's not about her being, that's not because it's her daughter, it's because she occupies a political post, right, in the campaign. You know, she is one of the forces behind some of this troll center bot army activity, the Xóchitl Lovers campaign, yeah. Very much has been tied to her, has, oddly enough, two birth certificates. Now, that's curious enough to begin with, but having two birth certificates can allow you to engage in some kind of questionable legal representation in her mother's companies, et cetera, et cetera. The report gets into the long and short of it, right? But there's a lot of there's some missing pieces here. They kind of get into this as well. You know, in some reports, Xóchitl Gálvez says she's married. Another one, she said she isn't, et cetera, et cetera. So, What is the impact of this news here? What is it? How is it different from the previous scandal that we were just talking about? How does this affect the political campaign?
It's very similar in the sense of it reinforces the idea that there's one rule for you, the average citizen, and another rule for them, the elite, right? If you, the average citizen, were to act up with a bouncer, well, you know, you probably wouldn't get out of that in pretty good shape. Especially if you were to hurl the kind of insults at them that that Xochitl's son did. In this case, again, we have a situation where another, you know, in this case her daughter, also, you know, nepotistically in the campaign, has two birth certificates, right? Which allows her to have, you know, different roles in, you know, Xochitl's different network of companies, right? Which is, you know, it's a form of fraud. And it's a form of, you know, legal evasion, right, of different things. And it just, it reeks of this idea that, you know, the elite will do whatever kind of shell games in order to, you know, have their advantage. And this actually came out in the debate last night when Claudia Sheinbaum very correctly put Xochitl Gálvez in the spot and said, you know, the reason why you don't want to get rid of some of these autonomous agencies, right, like the INAI, is because you're getting contracts from them, right? That's what these supposedly autonomous agencies are good for shoveling contracts into these people's companies.
Yeah.
Right? And then Xochitl comes out and says, no, it's not my companies, it's my husband's company. And that's exactly the issue. That's exactly the issue here. It's not my company, it's my husband's, or it's my daughter's, or my daughter has a place here with one birth certificate, or my daughter has a position in this company with this birth certificate. Right?
Yep. And that was the normal. That's how things worked in this country before López Obrador. That's what we talked about in the last episode around Salinas Pliego, where it was normal to get all these tax write-offs, where it was normal for public territory to be handed over so you could have a golf course, right? Where it was normal for you to, you know, mention you're married on one hand and single in the other, and oh no, I have nothing to do with that company, or this company, as the board of directors, is my daughter, but actually using a different last name, et cetera, et cetera. That's impunity to operate out of however they like. I mean, it makes me think, right? Xóchitl Gálvez presents herself as a humble woman who grew up selling jello on the streets to make a living. That may or may not be true. I have my doubts. But today, she's an extraordinarily wealthy woman. And how do you get wealthy in a country like Mexico? Thanks to your political connections and likely fraud.
Yeah, right. And, you know, anyone who's lived in Mexico, you know how difficult all this bureaucratic stuff is, you know? Birth certificates and CURPS and getting your RFC, your tax registry. And it's just, you know, the bureaucracy in this country continues to be a real problem for the average citizen, right?
Yeah.
And heaven forbid you have one letter wrong in your birth certificate or one tiny thing wrong. And this happens because a lot of people, you know, come from pueblos and, you know, not everything was, you know, especially decades ago, not everything was recorded. So it can be hell for someone to try to clear up problems in their official documents. If there's a problem with the name, if there's a discrepancy, if there's the most minimal discrepancy, that can make it difficult for you to receive services or get your pension. It can become hell. You have to spend hours and days and weeks and months going from office to office to try to clear up these things.
Yeah.
Right? In order to get things in order. And then you just see this daughter of this elite presidential candidate with two birth certificates. Whatever. Right? Because it's convenient for them. That's why this rankles so much. Right? It's not just a question of, you know, two different pieces of paper. It rankles.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, and it's not her first scandal, right? She's connected mm-hmm. to the family that was involved in the construction of the home where Xóchitl Gálvez now lives, that she paid under market prices, et cetera, et cetera. It speaks to a pattern, right, where they just have no scruples. And I think on that note, we'll go to our final segment, which is our bad coverage of the week. I've noticed some comments on the YouTube page that people are a fan of this, so we're going to make an effort to make sure we include it in every episode. And then this one, we're going to talk about the unscrupulous behavior of polling firms. Now, obviously, mm-hmm. a lot of people are talking about polls. It's election time. This is an image that was uploaded 11/17, the Sunday night, April 7th, by Xóchitl Gálvez herself, talking about the Massive Caller, which is a polling company, who released a poll done immediately following the debate. And surprise, surprise, I guess he who pays the piper calls the tune. Because according to Massive Caller, Xóchitl Gálvez presented the best proposals or was the winner of the debate, 60%, according to this polling firm. Incredible. Again, I encourage people to watch our live reaction from Sunday night, which really speaks to what actually was the outcome of that. Universally, totally understood that Xóchitl Gálvez did not win the debate. She did not do what she needed to do. She had a very specific kind of objective, and she did not meet it, but needs to kind of put that narrative out there. There's a number of other questions here on this poll. Who helped, did your vote change in favor of somebody? And again, 60% saying that they changed their vote to Xóchitl Gálvez. And then the final one here that she shared, who do you think is going to win the election? 51.1% saying that now Xóchitl Gálvez is going to win. This is not a trustable poll. This is not to be trusted. This poll is done in the service of advancing the political interests of Xóchitl Gálvez, the candidate. Because if you look at any other poll, any other firm, they will tell you the exact opposite.
Yeah.
Who won the debate? It wasn't Xóchitl Gálvez. I'll say that much.
Yeah, I mean, that's not even in dispute by anyone, right? The far-right network Latinos, right, who's funded by the Madrazo family and whose anchor is Carlos Loretta Mola, my God, they had a post-debate panel, and they even admitted that she lost the debate. I mean, yeah. You know, we're on the left. We have our point of view, you know, which we don't hide, right? But, you know, nobody thinks Xóchitl Gálvez won the debate. Not even Leon Krause. Right. I mean, not even Leo Zuckerman. I mean, these are people who are part of the right-wing ecosystem of the Mexican commentary at the real, you know, elite of Televisa and Univision. And
yeah.
Nobody says that she won the debate because she did really poorly. Right. Yeah. So, This one just really stands out. And Massive Caller has had a series of, you know, polls skewed in Xochitl's favor over the last several weeks. So these are the ones you're going to see her and ex-president Felipe Calderon and other people who are grasping at straws, you know, sharing on social media. Now, we could do a whole other episode, I don't know, it would be good to do at one point, as to how you can skew a poll,
yeah,
right? Whether it's in-house or on the telephone, whether it's landlines or cell phones, whether you're correctly, you know, sampling from each demographic, whether you're correcting for the people who don't respond. There's a whole laundry list of ways that you can skew polls, right? And people in English-speaking countries are hardly any, you know, strangers to that. I mean, the polling industry has been in crisis in many countries over recent years, right?
Mm-hmm.
But this one is just, I mean, this is just, you know, absolute bogus, ridiculous malpractice, right? And of course, it just, you know, further tarnishes the integrity of Massive Caller. There's just, you know, there's just no way to claim that she that she won the debate, right?
Yeah, and in a way they're doing us a favor, right? They're showing us how unscrupulous they are, that they're the lengths they're willing to go to engage in this brand of practice, to try to influence the public discussion, right? Like, this went up immediately after the debate, right? The idea was like, oh, well, the polls say that she won. I guess my impressions of the debate were wrong. No, your impressions were right. Xóchitl Gálvez did not win. She did not accomplish what she needed to accomplish on Sunday night.
Most of the polls regarding the debate, you know, came out along basically the lines of general polling, right? Claudia Sheinbaum has a 20 to 30 point lead, some even more, 35 points. And that's basically where the polling for the debate came down, which is very standard, right? Nothing like this. My God.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, that brings us to the end of our program. Thanks, everybody, for joining us yet again for another episode of Soberanía, the Mexican Politics Podcast. I'm your co-host, José Luis Granados Ceja, a Mexican-born journalist living and working in Mexico City. And as always, I was joined by co-host Kurt Hackbarth from Sentido Común.
And Jacobin Magazine. It's been my pleasure to join you again, and we'll see you next week as we've, you know, I already found out in the brief life of this podcast, Mexican politics are never boring. So we'll see you with another action-packed episode next week of Soberanía.